Yes, I think my presentation will follow really nicely from that. So it really are focusing on the rehabilitation aspect and sort of really drilling down into what happens during the rehabilitation experience. So basically what I'm presenting today is some work that I'm leading in conjunction with some of my colleagues. So we've got Anne from Gubin, who many of you might know, and Jen Che from Washington, our colleagues from the University of Otago, Christchurch, about orthopaedic surgery and musculoskeletal medicine. So Jen Dunn, who you know, Prof Rothwell and Prof Cooper. So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to just provide some background information. We've already had some really good background information, but I'll just add some information to that, give you a little bit of an oversight of some of our studies. And then some of our emerging analyses have really made me think about the therapy relationship and the idea of therapeutic attention in the context of rehabilitation. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that at the end. So I'm only going to talk for about 20 minutes, hopefully there'll be some time for questions. Just first of all, I just want to make some acknowledgements. So I've got to acknowledge our study participants who gave their time to help us with our research. Can't do it without them. Obviously my co-investigators who I've already mentioned. I want to thank the Joint Registry, the New Zealand Joint Registry, that they helped us recruit participants for a major study. Funders of our work, so Canterbury Medical Research Foundation, Age Concern. Also want to acknowledge the Canterbury Orthopaedic and Bone Research Association, so that's the COBRA unit, who are funded by Canterbury Orthopaedic Services. I want to acknowledge the University of Otago and also the Blue Academy for their assistance with this work. So, by my background, so we've already heard that joint replacement is really common. It's the most common elective surgical procedure. It's exponentially increasing. This is a worldwide phenomenon. When we look at New Zealand figures, we look at the joint registry figures. So the rates of hip replacements have doubled since 1999, since joint registry started collecting data. So in 2014, 8,300 hips were replaced in New Zealand. When we look at knees, the figures have tripled since 1999. So in 2014, nearly 7,400 knees were replaced. Not talking about uni compartmental knee replacement, just total knee replacement. So those figures are really interesting. So, I mean, I think most of you will know a lot of this stuff already, but we know that osteoarthritis is the primary reason why people present for a joint replacement. 80% of people needing hip replacements, 90% of those needing knee replacements come to surgery because of osteoarthritis. I know that recovery is usually pretty good after these surgical procedures. So patients report reduced pain, increased function, and better quality of life. They're really great outcomes. But we know that there's a group of people who don't enjoy those outcomes, and obviously we're interested in improving outcomes for that group. We also know that this is generally an older population. So when we look at the COBRA database, we look at the Joint Register, we look at our own study sample, the average age is sort of hovering around 64, 65. So this is an older population overall that we're working with. So turning more specifically to rehabilitation after joint replacement. And we know that rehabilitation is a really complex process, involves lots of different components, makes it really difficult for researchers to really kind of drill down understanding what makes rehabilitation effective. But we do know that it is a process aimed at enabling individuals to reach and maintain their best physical, sensory, intellectual, psychological, and social functioning goals. In joint replacement, so we're talking about hips and knees, replacements, rehabilitation might include some education, exercise, so in the context of physiotherapy before surgery. Let's talk a lot about the early mobilisation during the short acute stay after surgery, and then post-discharge. There's often, again, physiotherapy-led interventions around exercise, gait and balance training, etc., in that post-operative phase. But we do know that kind of approaches to joint replacement rehabilitation really vary across New Zealand. We don't know very much about what happens in New Zealand post-discharge, but certainly across the world in terms of looking at research, there are really huge variations in the way that rehabilitation is provided. So this leads us on to our first study, which is really trying to get a better view of what's happening in New Zealand around rehabilitation after joint replacement. So this is a role of rehabilitation study, so we're wanting to focus on the extent to which joint replacement patients, we're talking about hips and knees, patients with osteoarthritis receive pre and post discharge rehabilitation. We want to also identify whether there's any variation based on factors such as where people live, their ethnicity, income source. We want to see whether there are associations between the time they receive and intensity, duration of rehabilitation and outcomes for people in New Zealand. We also want to evaluate the role specifically of funding source to see whether that has an impact on access or use of rehabilitation services and also outcomes. So where are we at with this study? Oh no, about our second study first. So the second study was with the prior age concern. This was a summer student project. We looked at a scoping study. We wanted to look at what we know about from the existing literature about the effectiveness of rehabilitation after a joint replacement. We felt that this would help us position our own findings in our study. We wanted to, in the sense of the scoping method, we wanted to sort of scoop up all of the research and look at, you know, just the breadth and the kind of nature of the topic. What are the themes that we can see across the research? So we'll talk about the role of rehabilitation in study first. So this was an observational-based, questionnaire-based study, so we recruited in the joint register. So basically what happens is that every month the joint register sends out a mail out to people who had operations 6 months prior, and so we were allowed to include our study flyer in these mail outs. And so anybody who ticked the box that they wanted to hear more about the study, we contacted and invited them to participate. It's basically an option of people completed questionnaires by SurveyMonkey or web-based questionnaires. So, you know, bearing in mind this is an older population, we assume that most people would want to use pencil and paper questionnaires. That's the case. About 25% of the sample opted for SurveyMonkey. That's quite consistent with joint register as well. So we were collecting demographic and clinical variables. We want to ask questions about the nature, type, setting, intensity of surgery, pre-post-surgery rehabilitation. So where are we at? So, our target was 600. We've got 572 complete data sets as of last week, which is pretty darn good effort. We've got about 30 people in the process of completing the questionnaire, so we're pretty confident we're going to get to our target. We're not really close to it. So I think we're probably close for recruitment now. So we had a really good response rate, 78%, which is pretty good for this kind of study. And I think this underscores that we're actually dealing with a pretty motivated, pretty willing population who are really happy to give their time for research. So we really appreciate that. So I'm hoping to get into some data analysis shortly. But turning to our scoping study, so basically what we were trying to do here, we looked at the research, and we did a kind of overview of the databases, just hundreds and thousands of studies looking at the effectiveness of physiotherapy interventions after joint replacement, 2,000 bits of studies that look like they meet our criteria. And so a lot of this work has also been really well standardised by systematic reviews, so probably up to about 2013 the research literature has been pretty well summarised. But as typical of systematic reviews, the evidence base is kind of considered to be inconclusive. Most of the studies are considered to be underpowered, small samples. So, you know, this huge evidence base is pretty vast, but actually quality is really variable, so it makes it really difficult for clinicians to be able to apply best evidence to their practice. So for our scoping review, given that kind of landscape, we looked at studies that I published since 2013 that evaluated an intervention after a COBRA knee replacement. So basically we're looking at trying to understand the effectiveness of rehabilitation following a COBRA knee replacement. We wanted to review this work in the context of those systematic reviews to see whether there are changes in the direction of the literature, are we kind of finding more and more research sort of pointing in the same direction to give us more confidence in what the evidence base is saying. We wanted to kind of map what the key issues are for rehabilitation in this population, and specifically also to think about where this research could go in terms of new avenues to follow. So key findings, so we have 24 studies that we included in the review, and by far and away most of them were knee replacement studies, so I think 17 and 24 knee replacement samples, two were included both hips and knees, so that was just five studies looked at hip replacement interventions. Almost all of them used randomised control trial methods, and this is interesting in the sense of what Kit was saying, that you know, whilst the numbers are really important, we also need to hear the stories from the participants themselves as well. So randomised control trials don't necessarily always pick up on those. We'll talk a bit more about that in a moment. So in terms of broad trends, so when studies looked at comparing the exercise program, whether this was in the clinic as an outpatient or monitored at home through face-to-face following the visits at home, patients in the intervention groups seem to do better than patients who got no follow-up. So that's encouraging. So it seems like exercise programs are beneficial. It's also seemed like a trend that was emerging from the literature is that the phone monitoring exercise programs appear just as beneficial as a clinical home face to face to face follow up. That's really interesting. What we also seem to be finding out as an emerging, really consistent finding is that the type, the intensity, how long the duration of interventions were, these factors don't seem to be associated with outcomes. So it seems like when a study compared two different types of physiotherapy, all patients improved. When a study compared a physiotherapy approach with no intervention, the patients in the intervention group improved. So it seems like it doesn't necessarily matter what you do, it's doing something that seems to be beneficial. So this got me thinking, actually, about this kind of idea of monitoring, paying attention to the patient. Maybe this is a key component, but we don't really know, obviously, how much monitoring is important or why. There's hardly any work kind of looking at this in terms of this literature. It's still kind of focused on comparing broader interventions. So this got me thinking about the therapeutic relationship. And some of you might have heard from that case earlier this year, which you presented, with about the therapeutic relationship. And I think this is really, it's pretty interesting. As a psychologist, this is something that's been discussed and debated in the literature for decades, but it is kind of something that is becoming a focus on the physiotherapy literature. And when we think about what it is, we're talking about, I think, collaboration between patients and clinicians, and we talked about this in his presentation. We're talking about some kind of an effective bond between the patient and the clinician, and also the patients and the clinicians are actually all on the same page, working on the same things. So it also involves trust and compassion. And compassion and healthcare, I think, is something that I'm pretty interested in. We're looking at this a little bit more specifically in our traumatic brain injury research. I think it's something that has some promise. And you know, why is this important? Why are we even thinking about the therapeutic relationship? Well, there's quite a lot of evidence that a strong therapy alliance or therapeutic relationship improves treatment outcomes, leads to improvement in symptoms and health status. Patients are more satisfied with their care, they're more motivated, they're maybe even more adherent to their interventions. So it seems like it's pretty important. So this idea of therapeutic attention was something that was also of interest to me as well. It's not really discussed much in the literature, but it's starting to gain some focus. And so what this is really getting at is this kind of precursor to developing a positive therapeutic alliance. Sort of like someone sort of paying attention to the person as a unique individual with their own experiences, perspectives, attitudes, and the kind of a flexibility to modify treatment based on those priorities and desires. So there was a nice little paper published in Disability and Rehabilitation earlier this year by a Canadian occupational therapist who presented some vignettes of her experiences after a bilateral knee replacement. So she had a negative experience with a physiotherapist and a positive one. So she said, you know, in relation to the negative experience, my physio one never asked me about my life for me, am I even a knee to him? And she wrote, well, you know, I was far more motivated because physio two was interested in me as a person. I still did the exercises physio one recommended, but without the extent of commitment that I felt with physio two. Years later, I still do the discharge program physio two planned when I experience occasional knee pain. So that kind of underscores just the significance of that that relationship that she had with that physio, that second physio, that kind of had an impact even years later, well beyond the intervention. So, you know, are these ideas even discussed in the joint replacement literature? So this is something that I was quite interested in going back and having a look at the literature to think about. So we found a longitudinal qualitative study published in 2016 with knee replacement patients. And so the patients talked about feeling much more confident and reassured by contact with their health practitioners after their surgery. They talked about missing support, not being followed up leads to increased anxiety and stress. Having some follow-up, also gave them a point of contact, no visual to for advice, because there are lots of questions like, when do I go back to normal activities like driving? When do I stop using walking aids? How do I progress my exercise intensity? What do I do when my pain management isn't working? So when patients are kind of just left, they're often quite confused about, in terms of these participants in this study, but where would they go to answer some of those questions? I think that we're talking about rocket science here, but it's kind of something that, that seems important. So then we found a focus group study published in 2010. There was not much literature we were looking at this, we found just these two studies. And this piece of research that involved both health practitioners and patients after having a urinary acid. And so both groups of participants in the study identified anxiety, depression, fear and vulnerability as being really big issues of concern. Patient participants certainly described that when they felt supported by the health professionals, they felt supported when they were heard and given sufficient time to have their questions and concerns addressed, sort of echoing the things from the previous study. Health practitioners, on the side of that coin, also felt more satisfied with their subordinates when they had adequate time to speak with the patient. So everybody seems to be happy. The patient participants also talked about feeling forgotten by the health practitioners when the follow-up was provided. And one of the patient participants wrote, "One of the things I feel is really important is that physiotherapy departments and physicians don't forget their patients. Call and see what's going on. Many people seem to feel like they were forgotten. But after physio, they were out on their own and they were cured." So what did our patients, our study participants, say? So I feel pretty overwhelmed actually with the number of comments that we got there. We didn't specifically ask for additional comments in our study, but we took a lot of time to write quite a lot of stuff about how they felt about their surgery and rehabilitation experience. And there were certainly some themes around this idea of feeling really lost when they weren't followed up or monitored. And so one of our participants wrote, "I was not offered any rehabilitation or given any follow-up at home. I had to be for any of it. I was left alone, not knowing what to do, feeling frustrated and hopeless. I wasn't sure if I could not exercise or too much." Someone else wrote, "With the DHB rehabilitation, I did finally manage to obtain. I had exercises and used the bike equipment, but no physiotherapist understood what I was doing. I overdid the exercises. I did things wrong, tore muscles, pulled my kneecap sideways, overextended the knees, and now it flexed backwards." So, I think there's a thing going through here, but actually, physiotherapy follow-up was pretty important and is very reassuring for patients. And someone else wrote, "Here I am 7 months down the track. The rehab did help, but now I've just got to keep doing the exercise. I've had no backup for physio to see my progress. Sometimes I feel I've been abandoned and left to get on with it by myself. Sorry to vent out, but I feel that someone needs to listen to me." So these are participants all around New Zealand, not just Canterbury based. So, key messages. So it certainly seems that rehabilitation before and after joint replacement is completely beneficial. It's a clear and consistent message across the vast evidence base. Like I said before, much of the research evidence is based on those underpowered RCTs, randomized controlled trials. There are some increasingly consistent findings. So what is really consistent is that outcomes seem just as good with the rehabilitation as at home or in the clinic. This has implications for an older population who maybe have some transport needs, can't get into the clinic as easily. Different therapy approaches seem to achieve different outcomes. So getting back to the idea that maybe it's not so much what you do, but doing something that is important. And this idea of phone monitoring is an interesting one for me in terms of thinking about this as a kind of a low resource, low cost intervention. For some people, it just may be just as good as more intensive follow-up. And so we've heard already that numbers aren't the whole story. Randomized controlled trials don't really capture necessarily outcomes important to the individual resident joint. And so I think probably looking at the same more mixed methods approaches to research might be helpful in this area, sort of capturing the numbers, but also capturing people's stories as well. So I think that may help to inform the literature move forward. Last slide. So I think this idea of a therapeutic relationship, and even kind of a step back from that, just this idea that someone is keeping an eye on me might be a useful avenue for future research in this area. It seems like this is a really interesting kind of concept. People obviously really value follow-up by their physios and their health practitioners. Resources are scarce. In an ideal world, we'd all follow everyone up, but we can't do that. Phone monitoring for some might be a viable option. It might enable wider access to rehabilitation support, facilitating positive outcomes, reducing the risk of secondary complications, etc. There is no one size that's all recognised. That's really clear that some people will need intensive follow-up, and that's the way it is. But phone monitoring might be, like I said before, a relatively low resource, low cost intervention, with high potential really in terms of achieving and spare the anaesthetic alone.